Greetings, viewer. Welcome to my channel if you are new. We're going to hop right into this. Now, this is not going to be a guide or a how-to. It's kind of just showing me going through the steps, the process of what I'm doing to my truck. And in this video, what we're doing is we're changing the upper and lower ball joints as well as the axle shaft U-joints. And in order to do that, you basically got to disassemble the front hub. So right here, after I pulled off the outer locking hubs, there's a kind of a ring that goes around the whole thing. It's not really a snap ring, so you can easily pull it out with like a pick or something. After that, I'm pulling out the actual snap ring, which is on the inner axle shaft with some crappy snap ring pliers. Once that off, the inner locking hub assembly, I guess is what you would call it, you can pull it out now. Now it's sometimes a little stuck in there. You can honestly pull a screw from the cap and kind of use that to pull it with. I just kind of gently pried it with the screwdriver. It really didn't take too much force. Now I don't know if these are the original hubs for my truck, but I assume most of them might be the same. This is a 1972 Chevy K10 with a Dana 44 front end. If you have any questions about part numbers and stuff, I'll have most of that in the description, like the part numbers for the upper lower ball joint, part number for some of the seals, and the U-joints that I used. Alright, so after that kind of outer ring with those six screw holes is out, basically the whole assembly pulls out together. And there's a big spring with it. So I was kind of laying this down on the side on a clean towel, kind of in the order which I took it out. And right here, I'm just kind of showing how it goes together. You don't really have to take it apart, but maybe you can take it apart to clean it up and put a little bit of new grease in there. I recently did my front wheel bearings and stuff not too long ago, so I'm not super concerned about the grease. Once that is out, there is a outer spindle nut. I believe it's like the locking one. You need a special spindle socket to pull it out. You can get this. I got mine like at Princess Auto / like Harbor Freight, and you'll probably need a breaker bar for this one. Once that is out, there is a small ring with a tab on it that actually goes into a groove on the inner axle shaft. And the holes around the perimeter of it actually go onto a little nub on the inner. And that's how it kind of stays together. You got that tab on the inner axle shaft groove, and then you have the nub on the inner spindle nut, which is inside that ring to keep it all together. The inner one shouldn't really be tight. I didn't really need this breaker bar. You can see how easy it spun. The inner one is kind of tightened a little bit by feel, or you can go by numbers. There's so many different, you know, explanations online on how to do it. But as you can see, after I pull it out, I show the little nipple on it that you use to line up with one of the lock ring holes. This last piece I'm pulling out is, I believe, called the inner spring cup or just spring cup. And honestly, I don't know which way it goes in because the other side I put it in the other way. So I think it still works that way, either way. But anyway, when you pull off the hub, make sure you either take out the bearing or catch the bearing because it will fall out the front. Once the hub is off, you can pull off this dust shield / caliper mounting bracket with just, it's held on by 6 nuts and 1 little bolt on the side. After that is off, a lot of times the spindle is stuck to the, I don't know what you call that big piece behind it, the giant hub. So instead of hammering it off, what I thought was I could get just kind of like a 3 jaw puller, put one spindle nut in, kind of just threw a bolt in there to protect the threads. It's not like the right size, but it's not hitting the threads. And then I pressed it off, and it really did not take much force at all. Like, I was spinning that wrench really easily, as you can see. Luckily for me, I think my truck was, you know, somewhat taken care of in the past. So after that, I just had a little, I think it's a thrust washer on the axle shaft. And then the axle shaft is ready to pull out. Now, eventually, I do need to replace both inner axle seals that are inside the differential. I can't do it right now because I'm doing it in my garage, and the way I have my truck positioned, I don't have room to get to both, take both axles out. So now I'm just pulling the nuts off both ball joints, and then I think I disconnected my tie rod as well. Redid my tie rod recently, so it was just able to smack it up real easily. Now, I might have been able to take off that steering arm while still connected to the truck, but for me, it was easier just to leave it on that assembly and then disconnect it from the actual, I think that's called a drag link, and then I was able to get the whole thing in a vise. When you put it in a vise, just be careful not to have your vise teeth on like the actual, on the spindle mounting surface. It kind of looks like it is in my video, but it's not. It's below it. Now, getting these out was, you know, kind of tough, but not too bad. I think, like, again, I think my truck was in decent condition. So what I did was I heated up the actual, the conical washers versus just the steering arm. And I only use a propane little torch. I don't have like map gas or acetylene gas. After I heated up a bunch, I was able to smack the bottom of the steering arm. There should be some numbers below where I was hitting it. Kind of aim for that spot. And then once you got the conical washers loose enough, you can actually kind of twist them up with some vice grips or something. So now that that's out of the way, I was able to start taking the ball joints out. So I believe you gotta do the bottom one first. There's just a C-clip below it, which maybe there might not be, I think. Maybe if they weren't changed before, there won't be a C-clip. But I have a ball joint press, so I was able to press that out pretty easily. And then after that, you can press out the top one. And they both press out and press in through the top. Now I'm pressing out the U-joints from my inner axles. I just had to pull off the inner C-clips on this one. This one doesn't have the outer ones, it has the inner ones. After those are out, you know, it's real easy. Just, you know, press out each side, take off each bearing cap. So it's the next day here. I painted some parts. No, nothing crazy. Just clean them up and put some Rust-Oleum paint on them, flat black. So right here, I'm pressing in the new ball joints. Just make sure you do the bottom one first. It's pretty easy. Just make sure you are pressing them in straight. And then same thing with the axle shaft U-joints. I kind of cleaned up the portions, shot some paint on them, gave a little bit of sanding to the inside of the U-joint portions. And I did that on the ball joints as well. I didn't like sand it hardcore, you know, just, you know, cleaned it up. And then it's just press them in, put the C-clips in, and you're good to go. Now I had a heck of a time finding the part number for the seal that goes on the axle shaft. It's on the base of the inner axle shaft, and that'll be in the description as well. It's not exactly the same as what I took off, because I think it's from like a 73, but if anything, it looks like a better design. So, and I didn't change the inner axle bearings on my passenger side. It looked good, and then I had to change up my driver's side because all the needle bearings were like I'd on my head out. So the nice thing is the seals I was talking about a second ago actually came with the inner spindle bearings, so I was able to change that out on the driver's side. Now, torque numbers on this stuff, again, online, you're gonna get a whole bunch of different things. This is what I used. The bottom ball joint, I torqued to 70 foot-pounds, and I did that with the top one tight, and then after I torqued the bottom one, I loosened the top one, and then I torqued the upper ball joint sleeve, I think. It's what you need a special four-prong socket for. I torqued that to 70. After that was torqued to 70, I torqued the upper ball joints to 100. Now, right here is that seal I was talking about that I was struggling finding the part number for my 72 K10. I could not find it at all. What I ended up going with was a 73 K10 part number. And that's also what came with that seal. Another little seal that I couldn't find and where to put or where to use, so I didn't use it. And then the inner spindle bearings as well. So that'll be in the description, the part number. So I'm greasing up my shaft nicely here. I already put on that thrust washer, and now I'm going to put on this spindle hub, and I'm going to press it on. It doesn't need pressed on, but I'm going to put it on nicely with three nuts here to get it a nice crisscross formation. I already greased the inside of the spindle as well, and that new bearing, little small bearing I changed at the base of the spindle. So now I'm putting on the dust shield slash caliper bracket, six nuts, six lock washers, and don't forget that little bolt on the side as well. After that, the actual rotor slash hub assembly is able to go on. So I'm putting on the hub now, and I got the bearing in there to make sure it doesn't fall out. Once that's kind of in place, make sure you use the inner locking spindle nut. It's the one with the nipple on it. And use that to tighten the bearing and hold the rotor in place. I tightened it real tight to seat the bearings, and then I loosened it up and make sure it had some nice spin. I did not torque it. I just did it by feel. After that, the lock ring goes on. Make sure you align the tab with the groove on the inner axle shaft, and make sure the nipple actually goes in one of the holes. Next, I use the outer spindle nut, which is the one without the nipple, and torque ranges range from this from like 75 to 200 foot-pounds, so somewhere in there. I did mine at 100. Next, I put in the spring cup. Again, I'm not sure which way this goes. And then I put the spring in, put the hub gears assembly in there, kind of got it centered, and then spin the actual hub to get the splines lined up. You can put it all in as one assembly, not kind of separate like I did. The very outer piece on there, well, actually, when you push that in, it will kind of hold everything in place, and you can kind of tap that in nicely. I use a dead blow hammer just to get it started. Once that's pushed in all the way, you can kind of tap it in gently and nicely. Just put on the outer ring. It's not a snap ring, but just put on the outer, you know, locking ring. And then after that, you can put on the inner snap ring that goes on the inner axle shaft. If your axle shaft isn't sticking out far enough, you can reach behind your rotor and kind of grab where the U-joints are and push it out forward towards you. That way you can actually get the snap ring in the groove. Then put on the outer locking hub cap and make sure it's on right by switching it back and forth from free to lock. If it's on free, the hub slash rotor will spin by itself. The inner axle shaft won't spin. You can look around and confirm it. And then when you put it on lock and you look behind, you will see your inner axle shaft spinning with the hub. And that's it for the video. Again, it's not really a how-to or a guide. It's kind of just showing my process and what I did throughout changing everything. So, hope you enjoyed the video. Maybe I'll see you in the next one. Peace.